Okay. 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 Okay, good afternoon, everybody. So, yeah, please take a seat. It's a pleasure for me to welcome all of you to the 2024 Salam Distinguished Lectures, which has been a tradition at ICTP. It's an annual presentation of talks by renowned scientists to showcase important research developments and also to give some big picture and the forward view. And I'm happy to say also that this has been an activity which is very generously supported by the Kuwait Foundation for Advancement of Sciences, KFAS, and in fact, two representatives of KFAS are visiting us here. Special thanks to Mr. Jaber Al-Sabah and Ms. Ahad Al-Asuzi, who came all the way from Kuwait. In fact, this collaboration really has been very important for ICTP for supporting many scientists. And as it turns out, the new Director General of the KFAS, who has just taken charge, she is a woman scientist for the first time, I think, in the history of KFAS, headed by a woman scientist, but she also a scientist who has close connections with ICTP. So it's a particular pleasure to have you here. Thank you. This year's lectures will be, we are very happy to have Professor Stéphane Mallat. He is an applied mathematician, theoretical physicist, and professor at the Collège de France. He is a member of the French Academy of Sciences and a foreign member of the US National Academy of Engineering. He was previously professor at the Courant Institute of NYU at École Polytechnique and École Normale Supérieure in Paris. He was also a founder and CEO of a semiconductor startup company. He developed the multiresolution wavelet theory and algorithms at the origin of compression of standard JPEG 2000 and sparse signal representation in dictionaries with matching pursuits. So his current work is developed in mathematical models of deep neural networks for data analysis and physics. And I'm not in his field, but from what I understand, even before the machines were learning by themselves, as is happening today, some of the pioneers like Professor Mallat were sort of asking the algorithms to look, figuring out what to look for in the data and what are the relevant features to make sense of. This is especially important in vision and image processing. And thanks to the development of wavelets, which I guess he's going to talk about, which is the close cousin of Fourier decomposition. It allows us to compress and interpret natural images in a more efficient way. And this has been at the center of kind of a numerical revolution that has happened. So I'm very looking forward to his talk. I just want to mention also that he gave an online colloquium in 2020 during the COVID time. So we are very happy to see him in person here. The overarching theme and the title of this year's series of talks is Learning Multiscale Energies from Data by Inverse Renormalisation. And I had a good opportunity to, I mean, we came back from Paris in the car, we shared the car together. And I was very fascinated to learn from him. There is some deep connection with the renormalisation group, which theoretical physicists are very familiar with, but coming in a very different context. So I'm really looking forward to your talk. And then there will be two more following, two colloquia talk. Today's talk is titled Energy Estimation and Data Generation by Inverse Renormalization Group. Then tomorrow, there will be a special talk at, well, maybe I can tell you later at the end of this talk, but I might as well tell you now. At 11 o'clock, there will be a second, more technical talk specialized on log Sobolev stability, wavelets, and interaction energies across scales. And there will be a colloquium, the second colloquium will be at 2 o'clock on multiscale neural network models for generation by score diffusion. So I welcome all of you to attend these talks, and I now welcome the students who are coming in. Many of you are, maybe this is your first colloquium. I don't know if it is your first colloquium, but this is certainly your first Salam Distinguished Lecture. So you can look forward to a very exciting talk and a topic which is really at the frontier of really exciting developments that are happening around the world because of the developments in machine learning. Before I give the floor to Professor Mallat, I just want to also take this opportunity to say that we normally announce, 29th was actually the birthday of Salam, 98th birthday of Salam. In fact, I was in Imperial College. I was invited there because they inaugurated a library in his honor, Abdus Salam Library, to honor his legacy. And they had a very nice ceremony, a public lecture, and a number of very nice ceremonies. And we at ICTP have been giving the Spirit of Abdus Salam Award to anyone from the extended ICTP family of scientists and non-scientists, as well as from our administrative staffs, who have shown that they, who have worked tirelessly to further Abdus Salam's humanitarian passion and vision for cooperation, promotion, and development of science and technology in the developing world. And I'm very happy to announce, because all these three people I know very closely and I have worked with them closely. One is Rosanna Sen, who has been the secretary of our section for many years. When I was the head of the section, I worked with her closely. Professor Luciano Maiani and Fabio Zwirner, both very well-known theoretical physicists. But they played an extremely important role as chairs of the steering committee of ICTP, which was Professor Zwirner, and as the chair of the scientific council of ICTP, which was Professor Maiani. You can read about it more on our website, and the actual award ceremony will be later, but we announced this prize during this week, which is the week of Abdus Salam's birthday. So I will not take any further time, and I give the floor to you. Since you're starting a bit late, don't worry about the time. You can.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for this warm introduction. I will be speaking today indeed about machine learning, but also physics. And these are in fact very close fields, although it doesn't look like. Physics is really the field of high dimensionality, understanding interactions of particles, atoms, how you have emerging phenomena at the macroscopic scale. That requires to be able to understand how many, many variables interact. Well, machine learning is essentially about this also. Huge amount of variables coming from data, out of which you have to do a diagnostic, you have to recognize, you have to understand the distribution of these data. This is raising essentially the same questions. The mathematics which are behind are essentially the same and sometimes exactly the same. And that's why it's not so surprising that we're arriving exactly to the same kind of concept, the kind of tools that have been used in physics. And in fact, physics is a very important source of inspiration, is a very important domain of applications of machine learning. So that's why these talks are going to be at the interface between both domains. So the problem on which I'll be speaking during this talk and following up is about learning distribution of data. So it can be a physical field. And when you present talks like that at, in a crowd which is a mix like that, one of the issues are notations. So in data science, normally the data is called X. Here I'm going to follow the notations of physics. The data corresponds to a field. Think of it as an image. It can be a volume of data. It's going to be phi. And what you would like to understand is you have a system, you have a field, which is at equilibrium. And if it's at equilibrium, then it can be described by a Gibbs energy, which specifies the interactions of the different particles. And what you would like is to learn the energy. Learning the physics from data is about learning the energy. And the energy, it defines the probability distribution of the data through the fact that the energy is the Gibbs energy of the probability distribution. So question, can we learn the energy from just a set of observation, a set of data, which have been observed or which have been simulated? Now, the typical and simplest model, of course, that is being used in math and in physics is to describe the field as having a Gaussian probability distribution, which essentially means that there is no structure and that you see on the left. Then, of course, have been introduced much finer models in physics, in particular, and I'll describe what it means, with scalar potential, and that allows to describe physical models such as easing, 5-4, and I'll show another example on real data called weak lensing, which comes from cosmology. But the frontier really of physics is still to be able to describe systems which are much more complex, like turbulence, where you have geometry, very complex geometry, or here you see the cosmic web, which is the aggregation of mass in the universe, and understand the statistics of that. And that we still don't understand well in physics how to do that, because there are very long-range correlations and you have to understand the geometry. So the question is, how can we model the energy of such system? And if you can, then you can generate new sample, you can generate new data. And of course, the applications are very large. You have applications to physics to understand the nature of the interaction in your systems, but you also have applications to generate new data, new fields. Okay, so that's the problem. Estimate the probability distribution from samples. Now, if you look at that from the point of view of machine learning, you really have two types of problem. The first type of problem is an approximation problem. You want to approximate your probability distribution, so you need to define models, and the models need to belong to a family which is not absolutely huge, and therefore you need to model the problem. That's in physics often called an ansatz, or you may use a neural network to build your model. And then the second phase is the optimization. You need to specify the parameters of the model. The parameters is incorporated in this letter theta. It may correspond to millions of parameters in a neural network, or much less if you have a good model. And typically, you want to do that in order to minimize the error with the true distribution. And there are distances to do that. One is the Kullback-Leibler divergence, also called relative entropy in physics, or we'll see score matching. Different techniques. Once you have the model, you can generate data. In other words, you can produce examples which are high probability examples given your probability distribution, and that requires also to solve an optimization problem. So these are the two classes of problems that we're going to face with. Now, why are these problems very difficult? They are very difficult because we are in high dimension. And that's called the curse of dimensionality. Suppose you want to approximate a function which associates to your data a value y. For example, it can be classification, or it can be the probability distribution. And suppose you have example. In other words, you have example of data, phi I, for which you know the value of your function. You would like to compute the value of the function for any data phi. How to do it? The naive way to approach the problem is to think, well, let's look at the example that I know that are close to the value at which I want to compute the value of the function, and let's try to do a local interpolation. Well, that will never work because you have no close example in high dimension. And to understand why you have no close example in high dimension, you can take a cube in dimension d, so 0, 1 to the power d, and imagine that you want to guarantee that you have always an example at the distance epsilon. How many examples do you need? Epsilon to the power minus d. Take for epsilon 1 over 10, which is not very small. For dimension 80, that's already 10 to the power 80. It's more than the number of atoms in the universe. Now, we are not going to be in dimension 80, but in dimension 1 million or several million. So it's just hopeless. So the whole issue will be about understanding how to reduce dimensionality. In other words, how to capture structure in your problem. Now, one of the key structure that is going to go across all these talks and goes across all physics is the fact that you have an organization across scales. Suppose that you have an n-body interaction problem. So you have, here, n is d, d variables which are interacting. It can be particle, it can be agents in the social networks, it can be pixels into an image. Now, typically, you may have very far away interactions, but the far away interactions are often weak. If you look at a pixel, for example, or a particle here, the strongest interactions are going to be with the other particles that are close, with, let's say, your family. Now, the particles which are a little bit more far away, you cannot neglect them, but the interactions are weaker, and the one even more far away, even weaker. However, you cannot neglect them. Think of it, for example, at someone living somewhere in Moscow. You may think, I don't care what he's doing in his life, it's not going to influence me. Yeah, but if you neglect all Russian like that, you neglect the fact that there may be a tension between Russia and Ukraine, and the tension between Russia and Ukraine can change the price of energy, and that can change your life. So there are global interactions. But what it means is that instead of looking at the interaction of each particle, you can look at the interaction of the global group and look at the equivalent field on the central particle here. What does that mean? That means instead of looking at the interaction of d particle, you are going to look at the interaction of d log d groups of different size. Now, the reason why it's difficult is that these groups are also going to interact between themselves. And you have to understand all these interactions across scale, but in some sense, you've broken the curse of dimensionality because you've gone from d to log d. And that's the key point of multiscale that we are going to find in different ways, but that's the main argument. Okay, so as I said, today I'm going to stay in the world of physics there. In the next colloquium, so tomorrow afternoon, I'm going to move to much more complicated problem. Now you can generate, I'm sure you've seen example of faces, bedrooms, incredible images, with essentially the same tools. And what I'm going to try to show you is that the same principles are still there. The reason why you can do it is because there is structure, and where is structure? The structure comes in big part from the fact that there are hierarchical organization. You need to do scale separation to see them and to understand the interactions across scales. So the same tool that we're going to look today will come out when we'll look at the neural network applications. So now, what I'm going to do is to introduce the basic tools in machine learning that are also used in physics to do that kind of thing. So, as I said, there's two parts. The modeling part, the approximation, and there is the optimization part. In the optimization part, let's begin with the simplest problem. Suppose that you already know the probability distribution. You want to sample for it. In other words, you want to find a typical example which has a high probability. High probability means low energy. How can you do that? Basically, you do a gradient descent. You want to minimize the energy, so you change the value of your field in the direction of the gradient. But the problem is that there may be local minima in your domain, and you want to get out of the local minima. You get out of the local minima by adding some noise. What is this? This is a Langevin diffusion, which has a very strong physical meaning because it corresponds to movements in gas in particular. And if you do that, you are guaranteed to converge to a typical example of your probability distribution, even if the distribution is not convex, but it may be very slow. So speed is important, and one of the key questions when you look at this optimization problem is to find conditions under which the convergence is going to be fast. One of the cases in which you are guaranteed that everything is going to be fast is, of course, if you have no local minima. If you have an energy which has a single minimum, and that means that the Hessian of the energy is strictly positive, larger than alpha identity, and under that kind of condition, you can prove that you have an exponential convergence. Now, the exponent which is here, and that's important to notice, it essentially corresponds to the size of the covariance, and which corresponds to the inverse of your Hessian here. We'll see that. Why is that important? Because that means you are going to encounter a problem when you have a field where there are very long-range correlations. I'm going to come back to that, and that's going to be one of the topics that we'll look more technically tomorrow. Now, let's build a simple model, simple class. What are simple class of models? So in physics, the energy, usually you decompose it in two terms. You have the kinetic energy term, which corresponds essentially to the energy of the velocity, and you have the potential term that may incorporate all the nonlinear terms defining your physical interactions. One way to approximate the physical energy is to build a linear approximation. What does that mean? That means that you are going to define a family of functions, phi, which are your phi k here, and you are going to expand the energy or approximate it as a linear combination of these functions. You can write that as an inner product between your vector theta and the vector of functions phi. Theta, that corresponds to the coupling parameter in physics, okay? And building a model like that, in physics you call that an ansatz, that means you have a prior, given your modelization of the physics, that your energy can be written like that, and the key question is to identify the coupling parameter. And that will define a probability distribution. Now, computing the parameter is one difficulty, but the real difficult problem in that kind of situation is to define the model, is to define phi. When you have several centuries of physical studies behind you, you may know phi. When you look at a new problem, you may not, and that's where neural network can come in. Basically, neural network will be about learning the ansatz, learning the phi. Yes? Yeah, exactly. Yeah, the three coordinates are the physical coordinates. So you have a box of data, and you may have millions of points in your box of data. A priori, no. It depends. Well, see, for example, in example like 5-4, the phi is going to be local. But if you are in gravitational problem, it's not going to be local. So then the question is, you want to optimize the parameter. Now you have a model, you want to optimize the parameter. And the goal is to make sure that your probability distribution is close to the model. The natural metric to do that is the relative entropy, also called Kullback-Leibler divergence. If you do statistics, it means doing maximum likelihood. Maximize the log probability of the phi, find the parameters which has a maximum probability. Now, if you are in a situation of an exponential model, things are relatively simple because to minimize this quantity is convex. And what you have to do it are the examples. So what do? You want to minimize this, again, gradient descent. Gradient descent is essentially the tool of machine learning, but it is also the tool in physics everywhere. So you do a gradient on your parameter theta. Then you update theta in the direction of the gradient, and if you do a direct calculation, you'll see that the gradient essentially gives you the difference between the expected value of phi, of the, what is called the feature vector or the potential vector in physics, minus the expected value taken relatively to the true distribution. So you can view that as a moment matching problem. Now, The expected value relatively to the true distribution, you can compute it because you have examples. So you can do a Monte Carlo sum, which basically amounts to average the value of phi over the data that you know. The value for the true, for the probability distribution that you want to compute, the model, you need to compute the expected value. What does that require? That requires to compute samples and then do the averaging. This is very costly, because for each gradient descent, you need to compute samples from your probability distribution with your Langevin diffusion, average everything, compute the difference, and then go on. Now, there is a technique to avoid that, which is called score matching, that was introduced in 2005 by Ivaren. And the idea is very simple. If you look where the bad terms come from, it comes from the normalization term of your probability distribution. So what you want is to kill this term. To kill this term, you compute the log, and then the gradient relatively to phi. So that means that instead of looking at the difference between the log probability, you're going to look at the difference between the gradient of the log probability, and that corresponds to something called the Fisher information. That's what is going to be minimized, and if you do that, you have a simple quadratic problem within the parameter, very fast to compute, you don't have to sample anything, it looks like a miracle. The problem is that the miracle usually comes with a cost, and the cost here is the fact that minimizing this quantity is weaker than minimizing the true Kullback or relative entropy, because you've lost information about the constant. To understand in what sense this weaker metric is equivalent to the other one is again related to this notion of log sub LF constant, to the speed of convergence of Langevin. We'll go back to that next time. Okay, so now we have our two legs. On one hand, the optimization, and what I'm going to show you is that most of the time, the optimization is very badly conditioned. To avoid that, the solution will be separate scale and will naturally be led to the renormalization group. Now, we're going to be led to the renormalization group, not just qualitatively, but very precisely, the math are exactly the same, and that will force us to go into the math of the renormalization group. The second problem is the approximation problem. Approximation problem means understand what is the nature of the model. And what we're going to see is that, in fact, what is important is not to describe the whole object, is rather to describe the interaction between the different scales. How does atom aggregate to make a molecule? How molecule aggregates to make some kind of material, and so on. These different steps. That's what we're going to model. We'll see that this is much easier, and that's much better conditioned. And that's how we'll end up with interbalance. Okay, so the renormalization group. What is the idea? The idea that came out of the work of Kadanoff and Wolfson, that was in the 1970s, is to say, if you have a system at a very fine scale here, what you may want to do to understand its property is to reduce its dimension by looking at larger and larger scales. So how can you do that? You take your field, your image, you average subsample it, average subsample, average subsample. And now you want to look at the probability distribution of this field where things have been aggregated, averaged progressively. How do you do that? Where your probability distribution at each scale, you are going to describe it with an energy. This energy is going to be described by a parameter, and these are called the coupling parameters. And now, the only thing that you have to do is to relate the parameter at one scale to the parameter at the other scale, and that's called the renormalization group equation. Now, if you have a phenomena with a phase transition means you go from water to gas or from water to ice. Then you arrive at a very particular point where your iterations have a fixed point, and that was the key observation of Wolfson. And at phase transition, all the theta don't move anymore. Okay, now how do you compute this renormalization group map? Well, the idea is simple. Take the very high frequency image over there. You can decompose it into a low frequency image and a complement. What is the complement? The complement, which is here, is all the high frequencies of your image which has disappeared. We'll compute that in an orthogonal basis, but let's leave aside one second what basis. Suppose that you are able to do that. How do you compute the probability distribution here? You take the fine scale probability distribution and you marginalize it. In other words, you integrate it against the high frequency variables. Now observe one thing. This probability distribution, I can always write it as the low frequency probability distribution multiplied by the conditional probability distribution. Effectively, when you do this integration, you are integrating the conditional probability distribution. Now, there is a beautiful observation that Wilson did, is that despite the fact that the original probability distribution is very singular, this particular integral, you can compute it easily and approximate it with a Gaussian integral. So where is the miracle coming from? That's what we'll see. But now, before looking at that, we're going to look at the problem which we are interested in. In our case, we don't know the energy. That's what we want to compute. In our case, we have data, okay? So we have data, and what we would like is to compute the energy. What we're going to do is the reverse. We have data. It's not complicated to compute a model of very small dimension, 1, 2, 3 pixels, okay? We are in low dimension, that's easy. And what we're going to do is to go the reverse direction. Progressively, we are going to refine the model by going up the scale. Now, how do you go up the scale? You need to compute the probability distribution at fine scale from the probability distribution at coarse scale. Well, that you get it by the conditional probability distribution of the high frequencies given the low frequency. Same object that what Wilson was looking at. If you do that, you are going to factorize essentially your probability distribution as a very coarse scale distribution and all the conditional probability distribution. The key idea of all the talk and all what will come afterwards is that it's very difficult to compute P, but each of these terms are not going to be so difficult to compute. So you separate your problem in subproblems, which are much simpler. Now, why is that so? Because if you look at this conditional probability distribution, you can represent it with an energy. This is called the interaction energy of between the scale. What is the interaction energy? The interaction energy is going to be the difference between the fine scale energy and the coarser scale energy. But when you subtract the two, you kill the singularity. And it is, you kill the high frequency singularity for physicists, you kill the ultraviolet singularity. And it is because you kill this singularity that now you have a well-behaved object which has a nice Hessian, which is invertible, and you are going to be able to compute. And that's the work we've been doing with Thierry Marchand, Misaki Ozawa, Giulio Biroli, on which I'm going to elaborate. Okay, now we need to be a bit more practical. We have our high frequency field that we want to decompose in a low frequency field and these orthogonal variables. Traditionally in physics, people almost always use a Fourier transform, and I'll explain why the Fourier transform is not as appropriate as you may think for doing that. What basis? We'll use a wavelet basis, and I'll explain why. The key point is that it's going to be a basis with elements which are well localized in space. So this is how a wavelet basis looks like. It looks like a sine wave, but which is local in space. So I'm going to have several wavelets, three in two dimensions, and each of the wavelets, I'm going to dilate it by factor of two, okay, by dyadic factors. Now, and that has been the work of many mathematicians in the 90s, you can build an orthogonal basis of your space by using these three wavelets, dilating them, and because they are local,
You need to translate them in space, and this is the orthogonal basis. What does that mean? That means that a field, data, can be described by the coordinate, in other words, the inner product of your field with each of these wavelets. In physical terms, a wavelet is a wave packet. But you design well your wave packet in order to get an orthogonal basis of your space. How does it look like? And that was, has been used for compressing images. You take your field. This is the low frequency. And what you see here, these images, these are the set of wavelet coefficients in three different directions. They look almost completely disordered, very not much, not correlated. And that's going to be very important. You take the next image here, and you subdecompose it into the high frequency variable and the low frequency. If you want to see what it does to an image, like a face, that's how it looks like. The wavelet coefficient, whenever you are in regular regions, are going to be zero. They are only going to be non-zero where something is happening near the edges, where it's going to be very big, positive or negative. Locality is very important to capture local structure of your image. And then you do the same thing. You have the wavelet coefficient at next scale, next scale. Now, what's the relation with the Fourier transform? If you take an image, this is the Fourier support. So these are the frequency variable, often called K in physics. In math, it's rather omega. You do a first subdivision. What does it mean in the Fourier domain? That means that you've decomposed your big frequency domain into a low frequency domain corresponding to this image and three other images which correspond to three frequency bands. Now, this image, you subdecompose it into lower frequency here, three frequency channels, and so on. So what you see is that you are doing something which is also local in frequency. So you are local in both of the space, in spatial domain and in the frequency domain. So let's now look at what's happening on a simple but a case which raises a lot of difficulties. Gaussian model. This is turbulence in 2D. This is the Kolmogorov 1942 model. What does it do? Essentially, it proposed to model turbulence as a Gaussian field having exactly the same covariance, the same power spectrum. And if you sample your model, that's what you get. Obviously, it's not a very good model, but we'll begin with that. This is the energy. It's a quadratic energy, okay? What is the Hessian? The Hessian is just the matrix K, the interaction matrix of your Gaussian field. The covariance in this case of the field, so the expected value of the second order moment, is the inverse matrix. When you have a field which is stationary, which means that the probability distribution doesn't change when you translate, then the covariance is a convolution operator. It's going to be diagonalized in the Fourier domain. How is it translated? It's translated by the fact that you are going to only look at the eigenvalue, also called the power spectrum. And typically in physics, what we often observe is that these power spectrum have a power law decay. Power law decay, and that's exactly what's happening for turbulence, means that in the low frequency, it shoots up very high. In other words, you have a singularity. Singularity here means that you have very long range correlation in your field. That means that all the optimization algorithms are going to behave very badly because they are very badly conditioned. Now, and if you look at the size of the log Sobolev's constant or the norm of the operator, it's going to grow with the size of the field exponentially. I'm sorry, there is a plus here. Okay, why are things going to be better with a renormalization group or with wavelets? Because what you are doing is you are limiting your domain to a frequency band. You only look at a frequency band. And within this frequency band, the eigenvalues varies by a constant factor. And the fact that you only look within this frequency band means that if you look at the interaction energy, It's an operator which is perfectly well posed. And that has been the center of a lot of research in math in between the 70s to the early 2000s, understanding what class of operators have that kind of properties, and in particular for operators which have this kind of power law decay, the proof are not too complicated to show that once you go in the wavelet domain, all your operators are well behaved, but not only that, the interactions are very local. In other words, one wavelet is going to interact with a neighbor wavelet, but it's not going to interact with very far away. You've gone around the long-range singularity problem. So let me come back to the picture of the renormalization flow and the work that was done with Giulio Misaki, Ozawa, and Thierry Marchand. You have an energy, and I'm going to suppose that my energy, I can approximate it with my coupling parameter. What is the forward renormalization group doing? It supposes that the energy at very fine scale is known, and it computes the energy at the different scale, which amounts to compute the coupling parameter at the different scale. We are going to do the reverse. We don't begin from U0, we begin from data. And we are going to go from a coarse scale approximation and move up with these interaction energies. Now, how are we going to move up? We are going to move up by approximating these interaction energy with a model. In other words, the key step of the modelization will be to understand how to model the interaction energies and how to define the potential vectors to build this model. And what I will show at the end is that you can build much more sophisticated model, including model of turbulence, by going that way. You have a free energy here, which is the renormalization constant. That is not so important. Now, if you did that, what did you do? As I said, you took your probability distribution, you sliced it into components which are much simpler, and each slice you estimated by estimating its Gibbs energy. In other words, the coupling representation is not anymore the usual one that is used in physics with the theta j at a different scale. It is the very coarse scale coupling and all the interaction scale parameters. That will be the description of our field and of the energy. How do you sample? Suppose that you have a model like that. You first sample at a very coarse scale image. Then you are going to sample the conditional probability distribution, which is going to give you an example of wavelet coefficient. From that up, you can reconstruct your field at the next scale. You sample the high frequencies. Up, you can reconstruct. You sample the high frequency, you reconstruct, and so on. You go up the ladder, okay? The key point is that, we'll see, that's also fast. You don't have any more what is called the critical slowing down that has been facing when you go directly on the field. And I'm going to take as an example 5-4, which is a model of ferromagnetism. It's a model of how the spins are distributed on a ferromagnetic model. So you first have the kinetic energy, and the potential, what does it do? It imposes that the value of the pixels of the image is either close to -1 or to 1, which is why you have two local minima in -1 and 1. And then you have beta, which is the inverse of the temperature. If beta is very small, you have no Laplacian, everything is disordered, is as if you had randomly independent pixels. When you begin to increase beta, reduce temperature, you begin to introduce correlation up to a certain value where suddenly you have a phase transition where you see appearing these very long-range correlations. And then after that, it's a winner-take-all. Either most of the spins are one or most of the spins are -1, and you have these two phases. If you look at the power spectrum, you see that when you reach the phase transition, this is almost a straight line. It's a log-log plot. That means you have a power law decay, and therefore singularity in zero. Okay, if you take such a field and you want to sample directly the field by doing a gradient descent on the energy, it's a nightmare because it's a very badly conditioned operator and it takes a long, long time. And as the number, the size of the field grows, the number of iteration of your Langevin iteration grows more, more and more. So what are we going to do? Exactly what I described. Instead of describing the field from the energy at fine scale, we are going to describe it from the interaction energy at all the scales that we're going to parametrize with the same parametrization, two-point interaction and a parametrization of the scalar potential, and we're going to learn everything from data. To learn everything from data, we are going to either minimize the Kullback-Leibler distance or the score matching. Here it was done with the score matching, which is much faster. And then you can sample. And what you observe is the following. The number of iterations that you need, much smaller, because you don't have any more singularity, and is totally independent of the size of the field. In other words, you don't have any more this critical slowing down because you've decomposed your problem into problems which are totally stable. The second thing is that now you learned everything. You were not given the energy. So you can verify that the learning is precise by comparing what was the original synthesis, the original field, and what you generated. And you can see visually you don't see any difference. But you can also look at the statistics, the marginal probability or the power spectrum, and they are extremely close. You can reconstruct the full energy with the potential and look at the operator, which is a Laplacian. The key point is, why is it precise? Because you have a basis which is local, because your difficult part of the energy is the potential, which is nonlinear, and the potential is local in space. And that's why using wavelet, on which I'll come back. So you can do that kind of thing with other type of similar field. I say similar, this is the case, this is weak lensing. So weak lensing is a problem where what you see are astrophysical images. The very bright point corresponds to aggregation of mass. And that allows you to, how do you detect this aggregation of mass? By looking at the deformation of the ray of lights. And that's called a lensing effect due to it's a gravitational lensing effect. So one of the questions is to be able to describe the probability distribution of such fields. You can simulate them. You can do exactly what we describe, compute the energy from the data at each scale, then generate new fields. And these are examples where you can look at the synthesis with the same kind of model, scalar potential. But that's not going to work if you want to look at more difficult problems. If you want to get out of this type of toy models, and the problem of the renormalization group in physics, that it was beautiful when you applied it to ferromagnetism, but nobody has been able to apply it to more complex problems such as turbulence, because there is no good model of turbulence. And indeed, if you try to synthesize a turbulent fleet from such a model, it just doesn't work. Not only that, we know that these models require much more free parameters. So let's look at a complicated image. This is the image that you have over there, a boat. Let's compute the wavelet coefficient with different wavelets here, which are complex. This is the average. This is the high frequencies. You see the contours. Then you go to the next scale and to the next scale. So what do you observe? First, many coefficients are zero. Wherever the image is regular, they are zero. Second, you can see the geometry emerging. That's where the wavelet coefficients are large, okay, where the amplitude of the coefficient is large. The second thing which is very important is when you have a contour, you don't just see it here, you see it at all scale. In other words, the scales are very dependent one upon the other. If you want to capture the geometry, you want to capture the interactions between the different scales. And that's the problem. So let's look at the tools that we have in hand. Gaussian model. If you take a Gaussian model, as I said, you have an energy which is quadratic like that. Okay? Let's look at the Gaussian model over the wavelet coefficient. So it's just an orthogonal change of basis. You just do your orthogonal change of basis on your field, and you're going to get a new matrix, which is the wavelet transform of the matrix here. What is that going to give you? It's going to give you the interaction between a wavelet coefficient at one scale and one position, and another scale and another position. Now, one thing you can verify is that this is going to be essentially zero. It's going to be totally decorrelated. Why? Because these are coefficients which live in different frequency bands. They oscillate at different speed. If you try to correlate them, you are going to get zero. We're very well-known phenomena in physics. So you can't capture interaction between scale with a linear representation. What you need to do is to kill the phase, which is why also relus are so important in neural networks. How can you do it? Well, the first idea that comes to mind, you want to kill the phase, let's use a modulus. You kill the phase. So I just take the modulus, so that means I had a complex wavelet transform, and I'm going to take the real part, imaginary part, add them square, square root, I have a modulus image, okay, at the different scale. And now I'm going to build the energy, not just on the original field, but also on the modulus of the wavelet coefficient. In other words, I'm going to look how the modulus of the wavelet coefficient correlate across scale, across position. What does that mean? The matrix K here is going to give you the correlation of the original field. That's the usual term that will be the kinetic energy term. But then you are going to have a potential. And the potential is essentially going to give you the correlation between your field and the wavelets modulus and the different wavelet modulus coefficients. Now, the big matrix here, what is going to capture a lot of information, is going to be the matrix which gets you the dependence between the modulus of these coefficients. Not only they are going to be non-zero, but the bad news is that it's going to be non-local. Even very far away coefficients are going to be non-zero, because if you have a contour which is very regular, very long, a coefficient here and a coefficient here are going to be correlated. But you don't want that. Long-range correlation means that all your optimization algorithms are going to blow up. So you need to kill the correlation, and it's always the same idea. You want to take a problem which is not local, and you want to make it local. How? Same rule. Compute the wavelet transform. Why? Because why it's not local? Because it's regular. How can you kill regularity? You build a transformation across scale. So we are going to reapply a wavelet transform on the modulus. In other words, we are going to retransform this matrix. What does that mean? That means now we have two scale variables. It looks complicated, but let me tell you, it's much, much simpler than what a neural net will do. The original modulus, you retransform it. So each time, you introduce a scale variable to kill the interaction in space. That's the new scale variable. And you're going to look at all these interactions. That's going to define a matrix which now has very little interaction. If the size of the field is L, the number of parameters go to infinity, but very slowly, like log L cube. So I'm going to use few parameters. One observation, totally different from what is usually done in physics. What do you do in physics? Typically, you use high-order polynomial expansion. That was what Wilson and most people are doing. But the problem is that it explodes very quickly because you cannot estimate it. You can use derivative of high order, which is equivalent, is the Taylor expansion. But all these techniques, we're not able to approximate such field. Here we go in a very different direction, and all this is totally inspired by neural network. You never take a power. You take a nonlinearity, but the nonlinearity is homogeneous. You just kill the phase. And we're going to now see what it gives. I now have a model. I can try to estimate it. The problem is, it's going to be very unstable to estimate it for the same reason than 5-4. So what should I do? I again do the same trick. I separate scale, I look at the scale interaction energies that I'm going to parameterize. I parameterize exactly with the model I described, which has few interaction parameters. And then, once you have all the interaction energy, you add them up to get back your original energy, and you can look at how the potential looks like. You can recover the two-point interaction, which in case of turbulence is the one we calculated, is very close to a standard Laplacian, and you can simulate. And these are examples. All this is the work, by the way, that was done by Etienne Lempereur, including the model and the simulation, who is a PhD student at École Normale Supérieure. This is the original field. You have a database like that. This is for 2D turbulence. This is an example of 2D slice of dark matter, which comes out from simulations that were done at the Flatiron. So you have a database. You learn the probability distribution, and now you just sample the model. And these are the kind of samples that you get. You can see that visually you have captured the geometry. And how did you capture it? By capturing the scale interaction energies. And you can then do a statistical validation. The statistical validation essentially will consist in looking at the statistical properties. You can look at the marginal and verify that they superimpose the original and the synthesis. They superimpose, so you see one color for the turbulence, the dark matter. You can look at the power spectrum. You can look at high-order moments, bispectrum. You can look at the trispectrum, third, fourth order moments, and verify that the statistics are being matched. OK. So let me conclude for the first for this first part. For this first part, what I tried to show is that the reason why we can solve this very high dimensional problem is because there is a very strong structure which is behind, which is the scale organization. And the domain which has been studying this very strong structure is physics. There is a huge amount of research that has been done around the renormalization group in quantum physics, in statistical physics. That's a key tool to understand how you can go from fine to coarse scale. However, we are looking at it from a slightly different point of view. Because we don't suppose we have the model, we want to discover the model, but we have the data. That's why we go in the reverse direction. And when you go in the reverse direction, you realize that the key object, which is indirectly there in the other direction, are really the interaction energies. And these are the objects that you can estimate. So that is the key. In what I described, I showed that you can do relatively simple model just by looking at the modulus of the wavelet coefficients, but other models are possible, and we'll look at much more sophisticated model with neural networks. And then, of course, there are a lot of scientific questions behind that. Why wavelets? So I said because of local in space and Fourier. That's a question we'll look in more detail next time. I'll introduce in much more detail what are wavelets, what are their properties, and what is the issue with the Fourier transform. More complex model. Yes, it's absolutely needed. Physics, like turbulence, it's weird to say that, but it's something, it's simple compared to the kind of images that is being synthesized, faces, whole rooms like that, and so on. And the big difference, in particular, is that if you look at the kind of model I showed, they are stationary and they are ergodic. If you take a face, it's not stationary, it's not ergodic, there is a lot of structures. And still, neural network can do it. So the question is why? Is it related? And what I'll try to show tomorrow is that yes, that will be tomorrow afternoon. It is very deeply related. The principles are similar, but of course, the problem is much more complex. and there are beautiful questions around that. The other point that I didn't touch, which is totally fundamental, is of course time dynamics. All what I spoke about is a statistical, a physical system at equilibrium. There is no out of equilibrium questions. And that's of course the key question if you want, for example, to do meteorology. And these are very active research questions that I'm not going to touch during these 2 days. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Mallat, for this very inspiring talk, really at the interface of physics and machine learning. Very timely presentation. Thanks a lot. So is there any question from the audience?
So thank you. Very inspiring. I have a naive question, but I would like to see whether this is connected in some form to what you just told us. So if I think about learning something from sampling, and I imagine that I do an equilibrium Monte Carlo simulation, I know that the number of samples that I have limits somehow the, for a critical system, for instance, limits the length scale that I can sample. So I will only be able to, if I have 1,000 samples, I will only be able to see correlation up to some point. Does it imply something in terms of constraints of how this RG inverse flow works, or this is just...
But when you're speaking of the sample, you consider that you have samples at very high resolution.
Yeah, so, exactly. Yeah.
So it is very related, because if you have an estimation which is unstable, the number of samples that you need to estimate the low frequencies and the high frequency is much bigger. So it is very key to restabilize the problem first and then to estimate each of the pieces. So yes, you can estimate much higher frequencies if you estimate it interaction scale per interaction scale than if you try to estimate directly the field to begin with, because there you have a condition number which is ugly and your statistical estimator is not going to convert. Everything is going to be driven by the low frequencies, which are exploding. Whereas it shouldn't, because it's a very small dimensional problem.
Thank you. Yeah. Hey, thank you very much for this very inspiring talk. And I have also a naive question. So, usually, in a direct renormalization group, then you have to fine-tune in order to get to the critical point. Now, because relevant operators are typically, they are repulsive, the renormalization group is repulsive. And whereas when you do the inverse renormalization group, do you flow naturally to critical points? And then what about irrelevant operators? I don't know whether this is a simple intuition about how this generally works.
Okay. What's happening is that if you are in one, so when you flow on the reverse side, if you renormalize, you are not going to suffer from the critical point in the sense that you are not going to suddenly see a singularity which is developing and making your estimation which is unstable, but you are still, of course, going to have your bifurcation which suddenly appears. And that's going to mean that in the low frequencies, initially when you were above, you had a simple low frequency which was essentially Gaussian distributed, and suddenly, boom, it splits, and you have two local minima, which essentially corresponds to the two phase. And I'm not absolutely sure that I'm going to answer your question, but I'm going to, 1 second, follow this thread. What is interesting is that what gets very complicated, or more complicated, is indeed at the low frequency. And what I'm going to show tomorrow is that for phases, if you want to synthesize bedroom, faces, stuff, things like that, What is very complicated is the low frequency. Once you got the low frequency, vaguely the phase, when you go across the frequency, then things are much, much, much simpler, and you can build almost stationary model. So the low frequency problem that corresponds to the bifurcation, the fact that you have many local minima in your low frequency domain, you have it. This is the nature of the problem. But what you don't see is an explosion of an operator which makes your optimization explode because you did the renormalization, but like in the standard renormalization group. So now, because we don't have quite the same language, I don't know if I answer the question, but that's how I best approximated it, I hope.
Hi, so thanks for it's a fascinating connection between renormalization and machine learning. So it suddenly, maybe machine learning can make sense, you know, to a physicist. This is what it looks like. So, but I just want to understand the translation. So the basic idea is that you're sort of flowing to some basin of attraction so that you go from a big dimensionality of coupling constants to a smaller dimensionality. But in usually the critical points are fairly well known. I mean, what I'm saying is that the critical exponents, can you identify in this story well-known critical exponents that have been understood in physics, like Wilson-Fisher fixed point or Gaussian fixed point? Which are the fixed points that would naturally occur? Because they are determined by the number of spatial dimensions and the symmetries.
Yes. Okay. I will have two answers to that. The first one is, if it's about identifying the critical point, the exponent, you can identify it from the data by doing regression, but you cannot identify it on a theoretical basis because you don't have the exact energy to begin with. But I will answer in a different way. We don't ask the same question. And I'll say it in a frank way. I think that the game of computing critical points is, of course, very interesting, but it's the same game that has been played for the last 30 years, and you can get a little bit of refinement. We get out of the thing, the question is, here, really, the question is not to study super finely the phase transitions. When you deal with turbulence, there is no phase transitions. It's about studying the distribution. So it's about building models of things which are completely different. If the question is to understand very finely the critical point and the phase, then you need to have an explicit model of the energy. And that's you can do it for universal class because everything is equivalent. But then you are very constrained in your question. And I think in that sense, machine learning is giving a little bit of air on this question by saying, well, let's look outside. The main problems are not just to look at critical point, but to understand what is the distribution of turbulence around an air wing? What is sociological interaction between, I mean, to understand probability distribution, which still have all these multiscale properties, but which are not described by a phase transition. But for the phase transition, yes, we can't because we don't have the exact model. We can just compute.
Let me reformulate my question. So what I want to ask is that the low energy behavior in the language of physics is the kinds of basins of attractions that can occur are kind of classified by the critical exponents. So can you tell, given a system, which basin of attraction it belongs to?
No, because if you go back into, again, the idea of the basis of attraction is that you're going to have a fixed point, you're going to have a map and a fixed point. And that means that you are at a critical point. But most of these problems are not at critical point. You are not going to have a self-similar probability. In other words, that means that you restrict yourself to self-similar probability distribution. Almost all probability distributions are not self-similar. So what you want is not to describe the self-similar, but it's like non-equilibrium problem. You are not at the equilibrium, you are not at critical point. And then what's happening is that you don't have a fixed point and an attraction but a fixed point, but you just have a flow across scale, but you still observe that the low frequencies capture all the complexity. And frankly, right now, this is one of the totally open questions. I'll show tomorrow how once you get the low frequency of phases, boom, with a stationary model, you can recover the whole phase. But understanding the complex, and you, we can see it, all the computations of the network goes for the low frequency. There is no good model of what's happening here. And maybe there is a relation that could be done with models at critical points that I don't know.
Thank you. I'm here.
Oh.
This way.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. I was particularly intrigued by the part on turbulence. So this data that you use to learn the energies of the images are obtained by solving the Navier-Stokes equation. So we know that they have a dynamic that we don't see from the images. But we know that, for instance, for turbulence, which is a strongly out of equilibrium system, it's one of the few examples where you can derive from Navier-Stokes equation some very specific relationship between 2 points and 3 points correlators in the form of Reinhold-Kolmogorov laws. So my first question is whether there is a signature of this in the way you reconstruct the data, which is a very, very strong requirement to fulfill. If this is the case, have we learned something about Navier-Stokes by looking at the way you have these correlations across scales, this specific choice?
Okay, so the first question is, have we learned something about the 2 point, have we recovered the 2 point constraint? The answer is yes, but in some sense you may say by cheating. Why? Because we put it in the model. In the model, as I said, we are going to describe the field by a matrix K that we are going to learn and to compress. But in what remains are, in particular, a compression of the 2 point interactions, which describes the 2 point interactions of the Kolmogorov 5/3 decay law. So in some sense, it's this law is not represented in spectral domain, but over the wavelet domain, but it's still there. What is not there are 3 point interaction provided by the bispectrum. And there we regress, and there we do match these 3 point interaction. Now, in this example, I'm not certainly not going to pretend that that works in all cases and so on. These are ongoing work. But yes, there is something very interesting. And then we did in a number of studies of number of fields, is that despite the fact that we don't explicitly capture the third order term, we do recover it. And there is one reason, is that within this potential, there is these two terms. This term looks is asymmetrical like the third order term. This term is symmetrical like the fourth order term. In some sense, at the phase level, they behave like third order term, but instead of the third, the problem of third order term is that you have a coefficient to the power 3. And that's pretty bad when you have outliers because everything explodes. So what we do, essentially, you can interpret what is being done, is that it's like third order term for the phase, but for the modulus, you don't make the power 3. You keep to a power 1. The power 4 term, it's like fourth order moment, but the modulus, you don't put it to the power 4. You keep it to a power 2. So there are relations at the phase level, and what we observe is that we recover the third order and fourth order moments. So that's how much I, so there is a lot of interesting thing indeed. You know, working with third and fourth order moment makes a lot of sense because the mathematics are incredibly much simpler than working with a modulus which has a singularity. So doing the correspondence is one of the key also mathematical questions to understand why it's being recovered.
Hi. Okay, wavelets are great to analyze signals, two-dimensional, three-dimensional, one-dimensional for, I don't know, speech recognition, I guess, something like that. Are there cases in which analysis based on wavelet in some dimension came out of a surprise? I mean, it's not surprising that two-dimensional pictures can be analyzed by a two-dimensional filter. Are there cases in which it came out as a surprise?
Okay, I'm going to instead two level. Bad surprise, I mean, first of all, would like to say wavelets don't always work. If you have an oscillatory phenomena such as wave propagation, highly oscillatory, it's going to be a catastrophe. You have to get something much better localized. Where was this, has been the surprise here is the fact that when you cascade these wavelet transform modulus, you can capture geometry. And that was a big surprise. And I'll explain it in, and I would say this is still one mystery of the neural net. The wavelets, they are very local. So if you have a contour, you look at your wavelets locally, a priori, it looks very difficult to capture the geometric regularity. This is why during 15 years, mathematicians, including myself, have been trying to get rid of wavelets and develop things called curvelets, bandlets, stuff with geometry so that we could follow the geometry of the structure. And at the time, we thought we have to abandon these things and to go to something like that. The big surprise is that you can still rely on local filters like the neural network do. They always have 3x3 filters that they cascade. And if you put the nonlinearities between, you are able to capture the regularity of geometrical curves. And that's the, in other words, it's a big surprise that you can, with something which, like wavelets, synthesize something which has geometry into it, regular geometry. You see, to recover something which has a geometry which, like these worlds, given that you only look at the field through little square of different size, means that somewhere you've been able to capture that. It's a surprise that it can be done. That would be my, currently the surprise I have. We begin to have ideas why, but we really, I mean, the whole math community thought it was not possible for 15 years. So essentially, we lost our time. That's pretty bad, but okay.
Yes. Okay, thank you very much for a very inspiring talk. I think you partially answered what I'm going to ask, but still I would like to recapitulate along the lines of Antonio's question. Namely, you provide us two paradigmatic examples of 2D turbulence where there is no phase transition and lambda to the phi model where there is second order phase transition. And what about first order phase transition where you have nucleation of one phase inside another phase and all sorts of discontinuities associated with this? Well, you may say that this is a cubic term, but I would like if you tell a bit more about that sort of models.
Okay. Giulio Biroli is studying that. In fact, he's studying active matter phenomena where you have nucleation phenomena which are happening. And he's studying that within this framework. So they are right now able to do generation, but I'm not the best one to describe that, especially because I don't understand the underlying physics. So, but I think it's a very interesting question. It's still open, but there are positive signs on that direction.
Are there further questions? Yeah, I can ask mine, actually I have one. So these wavelets seem like a very natural basis given everything you explained to us. If you do not put these wavelets in the machine directly and you let the machine learn features, would neural networks, for example, actually learn wavelets? Do we observe this?
Yes. So we observe it in several ways. First, there was the first generations of the neural networks like AlexNet, where the first filters were pretty large. So they had the ability to, and then the first layer of filters, you can look at them. And they looked at them, and they all look locally oscillatory patterns with different directions. So they did observe that. But there's something more. Now what people do, if you look at ResNet or things like that, they impose that you have 3x3 filters, so very local filters. And then you cascade your filter, you subsample. Subsampling is equivalent to enlarge the filter, because suddenly the filter sees something which is twice larger. And then you refilter, subsample. I'll show next time, this is exactly how a fast wavelet transform is implemented. So what I mean by that is that in the architecture itself, the multi-scale representation is indirectly implemented by the fact that you have small filters subsampling at one point, small filters subsampling. So it's within, now it's almost within the architecture. Now, are there orthogonal wavelets? No, absolutely not. They can look very weird. Why orthogonality here is nice to have is for the math. You are computing probability distribution, you need a Jacobian. The Jacobian is one, otherwise you have your Jacobian around and so on. So for the math, it's important. For the actual computations, it's not so important. But the multiscale is there. For me, wavelets is a synonym to multiscale local. And in neural net, you have multiscale local, which appears.
Thank you. And actually, if I don't see a hand, I will ask a quick second question. So these modern generative models that are used, for example, in this DALI that generates these faces and artificial pictures you showed us, they're based on these diffusion techniques. If you train these machines, are they good at also sampling pictures with this very multi-scale type of spectra, or in this case, we observe failure and the techniques you propose are needed, or do they compete with what you propose?
Okay, so thank you very much for the question, because that's a perfect introduction for the last talk. The answer is, for score diffusion, when people didn't explicitly incorporate multiscale representation in the architecture, they were not able to resynthesize very large image. They began to be able to resynthesize very large image with architectures like UNET, which have explicitly the multiscale properties. And that will be exactly the topic of next time, to show why within score matching is following. And in some sense, that's one of the beauty of score matching, is that the mathematical description of score matching is really very clean and is a Langevin type diffusion where you also learn the energy. It's really exactly the same framework. So we'll be able to see in what sense is similar or not similar.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thanks.
All right, so if there are no further urgent questions, let's thank again Professor Mallat. Thank you very much.